It's a pleasure to be back after a year. Last year, I was in the CEO symposium, but I was one of the panelists. And several of you may have heard about Anjan Bose, who is the Secretary General of NatHealth, who was sitting in this moderator chair and did not make life very easy for us, by the way, at that time. But one of the things that we all discussed here is that we will make our lives easy and we'll be enjoying. And one thing is for sure that we would expect a lot of participation from you. And Chirantan was saying that this class is very vocal. So I am absolutely sure that you'll be asking a lot of questions. But welcome to the possibly the most practical session of this hospital management program. And I say most practical is because today you are in this next 1.5 hours, you have the privilege of listening and more importantly interacting with a collective experience of hospital leaders from the best hospitals in India of close to 130 years. So you have this very eminent panel, and I'm sure we would be able to get in a lot after this 1.5 hours, but your interaction is important. How we would be able to do this is that we have looked across all the various themes that is happening today in the hospital environment. And Chirantan also has crowdsourced, I always say crowdsourced, by the way, crowdsourced a lot of questions from each one of you, capturing some of the things that you would like to learn and you like to hear what is there in your mind. With that, we came up with three basic themes that we will be talking through and interacting with this panel over the next 1.5 hours. But before that, let me set the context. And this is something that you all know, but again, we have framed this up in the scheme of themes of what is happening in today's Indian healthcare. And these are numbers that is almost everybody has seen in some form or the other through either the Bain booklet or the NatHealth booklet or the CIA booklet or FICCI booklet, which comes up regularly. But some of them, it's very different, and that talks about Indian healthcare to be in a very different crossroad than the several parts of the world. So as we all of you know, that only 25% of people in India have some form of insurance. 75% is still out of pocket. The NCDs, or the non-communicable diseases, are progressing very, very fast, and which is draining the economy. Just to give you some examples, every year, close to 1.1 million people suffer from tobacco-related cancers. Close to 100,000 deaths happen from cirrhosis of the liver. There are close to 2.5 million people who live in the thresholds of obesity. So this is where the NCDs are boiling up. We all know and we all hear that the government only spends 1.3% of the total GDP in healthcare. And we are also hearing that 1.3% possibly will become 2.5%, but we don't know when. Overall, the GDP spend is 4.7%. So we all understand in this room that a huge amount of dependency on Indian healthcare is in the hands of the private sector. We understand the gap in bed capacity, and I can go on. So overall, what we see is Indian healthcare today is in a very nascent stage in certain areas and attributes. But having said this, it also gives us the possibility of a huge, huge opportunity to come together and make it a better place for our patients. So these are the series of our sector of paradoxes that we talk about in India healthcare. On one side, we see the government playing the role of a provider. Now on the other side, we see more and more it is moving towards a payer. We also see some of the disease burdens. We all saw the communicable diseases moving to the burden of non-communicable diseases that is happening. And I can go into the list, all of them, but certain areas, for example, for low income and geriatric population, the healthcare coverage was initially there. Now it is coming for universal coverage. So there's a lot of paradoxes happening. And one of the things that we were discussing at the start is, what is the role of the government? Can government play a much, much important role other than the private sector in terms of progressive healthcare? And the answer was a unanimous yes. And we will discuss this more. And then comes the role of one of the four P's we talk about. When I talk about the four or the five P's, which is the physician, provider, payers, policymakers, and the fifth P is the patient. today's patients, what you see here today, which come to you versus used to come maybe 10 years before, are much more well-informed, possibly a bit too well-informed of taking decisions on their own, which may be sometimes detrimental for them. And how do we able in this tomorrow and today's world be able to handle the expectation of such patients is one of the questions that we'll be raising. And that brings to a slide which we are will be talking about. What is the job or what is the work that involves for a CXO of an Indian hospital to be successful? We hear a lot of things in the press. Image, ethics are boiling points which is coming up today. And as CXOs of today's and CXOs of the future, how would you be able to tackle this? This panel will discuss what are the challenges that they face on image? What are the challenges that they face in terms of ethics? What are the challenges they face on one side on an expectation from investors, or on the other side, generating consistent, regular, superior clinical outcomes at huge amount of cost pressures? What they would do, on one side, there are who are doctors. On the other side, they also have to be P&L managers. How can we balance that? This will be a very interesting subject that we will be talking about. And we'll also talk about certain other things in terms of business model. What are the business model changes that could be evolving as a hospital provider that we'll be able to take care? Digitization, technology, coming up in a big way. How can we be able to tackle? And finally, I think all of us, especially the hospital sector, is facing a lot. How can you retain talent? How can you retain your doctors who would be able to have loyalists like 40 years of Dr. Ballal in Manipal Hospital, who'd be able to serve that hospital consistently? Or nurses, nursing staff, how can you retain them to the level that you would like to have? That's where the process that we would follow is we would ask the panelists first to give their points of view, and then I'll throw it up to each one of you to give maybe, some of you may give your perspectives, and then throw in your questions before we move. And I've asked Chirantan to help us if we are stuck into one topic too long, because we need to cover a lot of topics. He will move us on to the next topic. All right? So with this, let me introduce again quickly this esteemed panel. Two sentences I will use. Dr. Sudarshan Ballal, to my right, he is currently in Manipal Hospital, and he is the chairman of the Manipal Enterprises. Do you have the slide which introduces them? Okay, I'll use this here. So he's an expert nephrologist. He has got 34 years of experience close to, and earlier the medical director of Manipal and currently the chairman of Manipal Health Enterprises. So please give him a big hand. Then I would introduce Dr. Mudit Saxena. So he is currently the chief operating officer at HCG. 18 years of experience in Fortis, Wockhardt, and public sector healthcare. And I took permission from him, it is public, that from the 1st of October, he'll be joining as the group CEO at CARE Hospital. So please give him a great welcome. Dr. K. Ravindranath has flown from Hyderabad. Several of you may be knowing. World-renowned expert in surgical gastroenterology, founder of the Global Hospitals Group, one of the fastest-growing tertiary care hospital, which now operates with the Parkway Group. And I think the only clinical entrepreneur in this panel. So people will love to hear a lot from you. To my left is Dr. Ram Narain, a close friend, my neighbor in Mumbai. We use the same club and the same gym, and we try and see who's competing actually on health. So he's an eminent cardiothoracic surgeon, and he used to practice in Surat or in Baroda, in Gujarat. And now he's the executive director in Kokilaben Dhirubhai Ambani Hospital, one of the largest in the western region. And also he's a faculty in several of the healthcare management, and I heard that he already has taken a class this morning as well. So welcome Dr. Ramnarayan, and give him a big hand please. And last but not the least, Mr. Madhur Varma. He's the group CEO at Sahyadri Hospitals, and he has worked in several various roles, in Max Healthcare, in Fortis Healthcare, in ICICI Ventures, and in the local Columbia Asia Hospital. So give a big hand to Madhur as well. With this, let me start with the first question. And I'll start with Dr. Ballal, and we could go this way, and then you could take maybe 2 to 3 sentences or a couple of minutes of where do you see this concept or this thought or the perspective of ethics and image of hospitals going? Why do we see so many things coming in the press? Why do we think image management is important for the hospital? And do you believe it is so critical for a hospital to maintain its image in a situation where the environment, press, and the patients have very high expectations?
I'm very glad that you asked me this question, because this is something extremely close to my heart. It's right next to my right ventricle. Because I think image is everything for us. As a practicing doctor, as chairman of Manipal Group, I think image is everything for us. And to me, image depends on being patient-centric, ethical in what you do, and having good physicians. It's not the number of MRIs, PET scans, robotic surgery, so on and so forth. One of the biggest problems I have seen over the last many decades, which is something very, very sad and disheartens me, is that the loss or the deficit of trust between the patient and the doctor. And if we can restore the trust of the patient in the doctor, I think then we don't need to work on anything else to get our image up in the air.
Thank you.
When I look at the image, why image becomes so important at one point of time, I think a lot of these issues are springing up from the basic thought process of hospitals being profitable or being viable. And I think at times, to have an image, they also, the administrators, they correlate the image versus and the revenue as one thing. And I think you need to understand that as long as your clinical competency and efficiency is being delivered, the image and the revenues are just a fallout of that. So at one point of time, as long as you are dedicated to what Dr. Ballal was saying to your patient, your image would automatically come up. Your revenues will automatically follow in. And I think some of these questions which have come up, Sushobhan, is basically of the current crisis which has happened regarding certain programs or initiated within the corporate hospitals where you had especially issues related to organ transplants.
Correct.
And stuff. And I think that's where I would also blame a partly to the community, which is the doctor community also, which indirectly or directly gets dragged into it. And I think as doctors, sometimes they also fail to go into the details in terms of they're being too clinical. I don't think so. They need to understand that there are administrative and other issues also involved. And half the time they would forego and leave it for someone else, not realizing that as a part of your responsibility, which is a vicarious responsibility, that not only you, but the people under you are equally responsible for the action you are doing or conducting. So at the end of the day, I think the image, brand, revenue, whatever you want to call it, is a fallout of what your clinical competency and efficiency you deliver towards your patient.
Being a clinician first, image and credibility of profession is very important. That is what drove me into this business. And I can tell you, you can build image by doing a good clinical practice, giving good clinical outcomes, patient safety. I think that is something which is very important. If you can make those things happen, image will come. But I agree with Mudit. Of late, media has become too active, aggressive, irresponsible in many times. They are going into the unnecessary details without understanding it, publishing it in a negative way. It's definitely affecting and also taking the toll on the healthcare, both administration and clinicians. We need to work on that, certainly, and we can't reform the media overnight or anything. This, I think, it'll take some time. By and large, if your patients are happy, and if they are the one who are going to send you more patients, and they are convinced that this is the best organization, this is the best doctor I've come, the media reports are not only temporary. By evening they'll forget if it is a newspaper, by evening it goes into the dustbin. If it is a television media, maybe by next day it goes into loss of memory. My take on image and managing the hospital on one side and the other side is a profitability. The most important thing is what we as a global hospital we've done is we worked on our clinical programs. We created something which others don't do initially. Now many people do. Again, very controversial area today. Organ transplantation is one of our forte. We have put our systems in place from day one. Ethics and values are most important. So we stuck to our guns and produced the best results. And of course, it is not economical initially, but once you make a name and you produce results and you publish your results and make it transparent, then the image can't be damaged that easily. Because medical profession and patients are happy, then rest of the things will slowly, it'll fade away once you're consistent in your outcomes and your patient perception. I think that's something which we stuck, creating centers of excellence, and we continue to do the same thing. And we haven't done major advertisements, any of those things. Our spend on branding, marketing is almost very negligible in our organization. But still, we got somewhere because of our, again, good work. Image we have to manage. As we go along, we have to face this media and few other areas. But I think we have to figure out how to neutralize some of these negative factors.
Thank you. While we move into Madhur, one of the questions that I would ask each one of you to put it in your minds and think, and obviously the panel as well, it comes very clearly that sometimes perception of healthcare is almost, and it's I do agree healthcare is absolutely a noble profession, but the perception of healthcare is you cannot make profits or almost not too many profits. So if you in an IT industry, if you are making profits, margins, high margins, I think it is almost acceptable. But when you are in a private hospital or in a corporate world, in a corporate hospital even, sometimes, and I can say talk on the majority of public, it almost seems, hey, the hospitals cannot make too much of profits. Is making profits wrong? Is the question I think you need to all think through while I ask Madhur to give his perspectives.
So I was actually about to say the same thing. Historically, healthcare is a field of philanthropy, and it changed from there to being an industry. And I think mindsets haven't changed, at least within the hospital. Two, that the consumer has changed. The expectation of service has changed. If I can walk into an ATM, withdraw my money, print my boarding pass, go to the airport, why shouldn't the same expectation of service be in a hospital? So that era of the patient regarding the doctor as the god is gone. And it is a consumer which is asking for service and therefore needs delivery. Any hospital with positive clinical outcomes over a period of time will succeed. There is no doubt about it. But having said so, information availability and the speed at which information travels today versus what it was 10 years ago is very different. Psychology tells us that positives are less spoken of than negatives. So it's the environment is quite different, and I think just focusing on restoring the faith of the consumer or the patient, first is it as a consumer, customer or patient. I think currently they're all customers who expect a level of service to be delivered both clinically and non-clinically for the money that they pay. I think the image comes out of there. And second very important part in the image is transparency. Healthcare as an industry has been opaque, both in pricing as well as in procedures. Very few doctors would sit down with the patient and explain what the procedure is and what the complications could be and so far and so forth. While that is something which is, I think, going to be the forefront of where image will be created as to how we are transparent, not only with our pricing, but more so about procedures.
I agree completely, and what you said is very true, is there is definitely an opacity in terms of the value that is being got out of a healthcare service versus the price that is being paid. And like, it's not very clear as a matrix, so that's a great point that you raised. Dr. Ram.
Takeaways from everyone. Essentially, we are at a point in healthcare where, as he was saying and other panelists have said, it was perceived as a noble profession. It was a service to be rendered to humanity, and there is this dichotomy that how do you convert a service into a business? And that is what is happening when we are ramping up and there's money coming in from corporates and the private sector. The consumer, the public, is not able to come to terms with the fact, as Sushobhan said, that, excuse me, this is almost a service to humanity. How can you make money out of it? And if you ask any consumer, and if you ask the government of India also, probably they will say you should deliver service at cost. You have no right to make even 1 rupee on anything. And then you would have fulfilled your mission, your vision, your Hippocratic oath, and your business model. This is the model they would like us to roll out. Obviously, that is not a reality because the money is coming from somewhere else. But at the same time, I think the biggest issue is we are talking about service excellence, whether it's clinical outcomes or hospitality services or business processes. I think one of our biggest issues and why we are under trial by media is we are not a regulated industry. We have not regulated ourselves, so we have set ourselves up to be attacked by the media, by the government, because there is no regulation. Today, you do not have to report your clinical outcomes to anyone. Today, you do not have someone like a TARI monitoring us. Today, we have a Medical Council of India, with which we are responsible, is essentially toothless, has no capacity to regulate any practitioner of medicine, has no capacity to regulate outcomes, there's no reporting system for outcomes. We have no standardization of prices. There is no one regulating prices. And we have got into this tailspin where we have become the softest targets available for the media. And therefore, we are under trial by media and we have nowhere to go, because we ourselves is a scenario where we don't have the answers, whether it's regulation, whether it's reporting outcomes, where we should be, what we should be delivering to the consumer. And with this, if we don't set this right, there is no way that the trust deficit is going to be bridged. We will not be able to rebuild our image unless we put our house in order. I was talking in the morning to them. We have islands of excellence, but they are still islands of excellence. If you go across the country, that is not the story. If you go across the city, it is not the story. And that is what the public is crying for, the consumer is crying for. Show me standardization, show me transparency, show me a regulated industry like telecom or financial services. Why are you guys not regulated? Without this, our image is never going to improve.
I agree, and we were discussing in the afternoon as well that even when you look at the regulations from the government perspective, so there are different ministries, and several ministries don't speak to each other. So one of the things which the healthcare industry is looking at is talking to the PMO or the Prime Minister's office to bring certain of the ministries together so that we could have this, what you said, so-called regulation, which will be beneficial for balance structure and image. So let me open up to the audience, and maybe some of you could talk about your perspectives about where do you see the image perception of the patients or the general public on hospitals are going.
Okay, my name is Vijay Sethi. I'm the Director of Administration Hospitality with the Fortis Gurgaon Hospital.
Excellent.
And I'm not coming from the hospital industry. I'm a hospitality industry person. But been in the industry for about 2 years now. You know, we've been talking about transparency and ethical practices, and then Dr. Narain saying that there is nobody to regulate us. I mean, it's been years now. I mean, in the last 10 years, I think the healthcare has been a very fast track, if you look at the last 10 years. And I worked with Dr. Panda for 1 year also in the Asian Art Institute many, many years ago. Why do we need the government to get into regulating the doctors, whether it's a transparency or whether it is the ethical practices or whatever maybe the impression is being carried out outside the hospital that hospitals are fleecing us, they are not supposed to make money. Why is it that we're still talking about, even after having come and evolved so much in the healthcare industry, why is that the MCI, the Medical Council of India, do not take this forward and ask what Dr. Narain said? Why is that we want government? When the government will come in, perhaps, I'm sure, we will probably clip that, why is government controlling us? It's like always the other industries do. So why is that the doctor fraternity or the MCI itself don't take charge of this and start making some step forward?
I think one of the central issues in our country, unlike the Royal Colleges in the United Kingdom or the boards in the United States of America or the associations, one of the central issues we are faced with the Medical Council of India and all other councils, these are elected bodies. Unfortunately, I'm going to set the cat among the pigeons, maybe I should say this. The elected members have an agenda which is not exactly the agenda we are looking for. They are supposed to be regulators, but the tenure is spent in partly regulating. But what we really require, I can talk about the UK system, I can talk about the North American system, where what you said happens. They self-regulate, the associations and the colleges self-regulate, they audit, they look at outcomes, they take action, they bring about changes. The National Institute of Clinical Excellence gives guidelines in the United Kingdom. The American Heart Association gives guidelines. Dr. Ballal, of course, is a nephrologist. You have the Kidney Foundation. They give guidelines. Self-regulation. And they have regulated themselves so well. Because those people are committed to excellence, and this is what they do in that tenure, how to raise the standard of practice of that particular specialty. Unfortunately, we have not evolved to that point. Will we? I think we will. It's just forums like this. We will evolve, and if we self-regulate, then we will not have these agencies coming in and telling us what to do. And we will not be soft targets, because the public will see that we are doing an excellent job of regulating ourselves. The moment we do that, your image is home and dry.
If you look at the healthcare sector up till now, if you were looking at other industries, has become privatized and more private players at a higher level in terms of corporate structure of hospitals. Chain of hospitals have sprung up in past 5 to 10 years only. Prior to that, healthcare market was still being serviced by private players, which almost still the figures are the same. The government participation has fallen down tremendously. But this was a very fragmented market. There were small nursing homes where, if you remember, when you were young, your parents would go. They would not go to bigger hospitals because they were related to either bigger cities. Smaller centers would be with nursing homes, and that was a very fragmented market. There were associations, medical council associations, local council associations, where the medical fraternity was there, and these councils or associations were self-serving councils. So if they had a personal interest in that, they would all come together. But if it wouldn't have it, they would not take up the responsibility. On the contrary, the government programs which are there, whether it was steel industry or any of the industries, thanks to the red tapism, they were not private players allowed in there. It was mainly through government-aided or government-promoted areas only, which were automatically coming under a lot of regulations. In 1990 onwards, when we started into an area where we said, we'll deregularize, we'll remove the red tapes, we'll invite the foreign investors and participation started happening in all sectors. In fact, healthcare started picking up in 2000 onwards only, 2002, 2004 onwards. So other industries gained up, but they had a certain logical way in terms of being regulated prior to that because of the government rules and regulations in that industry existing. Healthcare was nascent, it was never monitored. As I said, it was very fragmented related to small councils and associations and nursing homes which were delivering the healthcare. But when you look at in terms of when the private equity funding came in or the investors came in or private entrepreneurs started exploring and building up bigger hospitals, they still went into an unregulated market. So rather than getting more regulated or registered or legalized or following a certain obligatory pathways, it was a fragmented market, and they started monopolizing their fragmented markets to the best of their health. Of course, it helped certain chains. It also affected adversely to the people and the people who had their interest, as well as the doctors and the patients both. It has affected both of them. look at the same thing when we're talking about healthcare. I think we get very, very concentrated on hospitals. Hospitals contribute about 72% of the healthcare market, but remaining, say, look at the pharma industry. It was still regulated. You can't start manufacturing pharma tablets at the back of your house in your courtyard, but a doctor can start that without being accountable to anyone as long as he has an MBBS degree and he can start practicing. You can't start manufacturing your pharma drugs there. Similarly, you can't make a heart or a prosthesis somewhere inside your house and come outside and say, tomorrow I've done this. It has to undergo a trial. It has to get a validation to be inserted somewhere, until unless you're doing quackery. So all these areas, they already had a certain regulation. It was only the hospital or the healthcare delivery aspect which was unregulated. And I personally feel over the years it has got multiplied. And when you multiply a negative, it gets multiplied into a more negative. That's what has happened. But I think in coming times, the interesting part which is evolving and what Dr. Ram was also saying was that our interests are being more or less regulated by the financial takeaways. And currently, the way government is moving, where it is promoting insurance sectors, where it is promoting healthcare, which has to be more through a third-party associates, the moment it is coming in, they are demanding a certain amount of outcome as a kind of a marker or for your remunerations. They're also looking at your competency, whether your doctors are there. In fact, the current, if you're aware, the current thing is that if new hospitals will be remunerated, if they're NABH, then only. In fact, now it is like if you have to have an NABH, otherwise you can't run that hospital only. So it's going to in that direction. I think, interestingly, since the body ourselves, we were not able to regulate, the market forces are now making me regulate myself, which I personally feel is better for the consumer because it is more of a consumer driven rather than driven by me. And it will work in the favor of the consumer. And I think in the current scenario, in any scenario, when the consumer takes up the charge, it becomes far more regulated and it is far more introspective for the industry and is far more helpful for the society.
I'm Sunil Mehta. I'm GM Operations at Max Hospital, Bathinda in Punjab.
Regarding
the image of a hospital and a doctor, when a negative news comes in the newspaper, the image of hospital as well as doctor suffers, albeit for a shorter duration as the memory of the public is, short. So because the memory of the public is short and many new hospitals are coming up, many doctors are coming in the market and they are starting their practices. So we need branding and marketing also. Now, one aspect is that Medical Council of India, they have so restrictive rules on the advertisement and branding. What I say is that there has to be such rules and restrictions, but the framework can be a bit expanded. What are we doing? Who is representing from our side to tell the Medical Council of India that please relax some norms for us? Number one. Number two, this is regarding the prices. Like stent prices, now the government is capping the stent prices. Now, you know, CGHS capped the stent prices much earlier. All the hospitals, I think 30 to 40% revenue is through PSU, CGHS, and ECHS business. And government had capped stent rates and cost of some of the medicine, IOLs also in cataract surgeries, much a few years before. What had we done? Who represented from our side and negotiated with the government? No, this price has to be a bit on the higher side. It's at a very lower side. Now government is restricting the the drugs cost. So who is representing from our side? See, private sector in India is catering to the needs of the patients largely. So my question is, where is the representation from our side?
Yes, so I can respond because so what has happened is we created, so one is AHPI, RP is a body which has been created. We have associations of hospitals, which is there in Bombay, which represents nursing homes. But what happened is 3 or 4 years back, the entire healthcare ecosystem came in together and created NatHealth. You must have heard. And NatHealth was created with Dr. Pratap Reddy being the first president. And it had every stakeholder in it. And this is a very unique body, which I doubt anywhere in the world it exists, where you have the diagnostics, the medical equipment, except the pharmaceuticals, the health insurance, the providers, the nursing homes. Everybody is in together. And a lot of representation has happened through this body because what happens, it takes the interest of a medical device supplier, as also it takes care of the interest of a provider. It also takes care of the payer, which is a health insurance body, along with the diagnostics. Representations have happened. In some cases, we have been successful. Some cases, it is not. But I can tell you, if this representation was not done a couple of years back onwards, we would have seen a much deteriorating state than what it is today. Today you see, just to give you an example, the drug cap, this capping of stents have happened, and you're absolutely right. CGH is already, that capping was done at 25,000 rupees, and 30% of the flow was going there. So if the objective of serving the poor was already met, why do you want to bring the entire stent to 25,000 rupees and make people who can pay a good quality stent at 1,50,000 to come back to 25,000? I think there is a difference in understanding here. And I can tell you, because what has happened today, except for stents, orthopedic implants, intraocular lens, then valves and others are under the current thought process of coming into the ceiling. But this is being stalled for the timing. So they're looking at a Medical Device Act and coming together. So a lot of work is happening, I can tell you, but we can discuss it more offline. But having said this, I think there are pros and cons of regulation. But if you ask me, my personal perspective is there has to be a form of regulation. It could be self-regulation, it could be government-inflicted regulation, so that the perception of image that is coming up actually be much more standardized and uniform. Today, image management, the perception that we see, which is tweaked in the minds of the public, comes out of the fact that since there is no standard, everyone tries to play their own standard, and that's the reason it come up. Which brings me to a question, which considering the image, the profitability that we just talked about, and the question is to Dr. Ravindranath. So we see a lot of foreign direct investments and private equity coming up. No one's fallen down, right? So what about? Okay. So a lot of private equity, foreign investments are coming in into the hospital area. And you have been already experiencing it through the Parkway Group, which is coming as a foreign entity, coming here, having a different profitability expectation, but maybe not really understanding the nuances of the reality of Indian healthcare system. So as a clinical entrepreneur, you being the one of this area, how you balance the expectation of that investor versus the reality without compromising on outcomes, which you rightly talked about?
Well, I think that's a very difficult and interesting question as well. As global we evolved, we had private equity and also high net worth individual. Initially, we all started as only doctors as promoters. Majority of it is mine. When we had a private equity and high net individual comes into the organization, their expectations were different. In fact, it was a shock for me. Fortunately, between the doctors, all of us had majority, we could avoid a lot of push they have given to me in compromising. We didn't compromise on any of the clinical standards or safety, patient safety or outcomes. We didn't allow them to be honest, if I have to say, honestly, we didn't allow them to interfere with clinical decision making and also clinical excellence. But it comes to a point where when they need exit, then you get into problems.
Mm.
They'll pull out all the each of the small guns, and then they'll pull out the AK-45. That kind of situation comes, and then that is the time I had to make a decision, I'm being honest. If we have to take this institution to the next level and also the where we dreamt, we need a partner who understands healthcare, who is a long-term player, who we can partner with and take the institution to the logical conclusion. That's where I had to make a decision on a strategic partner who has been in healthcare. And Parkway CEO, Dr. Seelington, is a good friend of mine. We had personal discussions. we put a 10-year goal, what we want to achieve between both of us, and then we did all that. To be honest, today the pressure is not there. The pressure is only to build clinical programs to the next level, and also, of course, profitability, we always have to have an eye on that. But that is not everything. That is something which can come later also, provided we have a robust plan and also a good business plan. That is something which is, I can see in the last 8-9 months, a huge difference in the way we approach the whole organization or future of the organization. So private equity expectations are very high. They want exit in 4 years, 5 years, with at least 25% return. Healthcare cannot give that kind of returns, honestly. It's only on valuations when there is a huge demand and supply gap, you might get valuation. But the guy who gives higher valuation, he wants exit another 4 years, he will not get it. I can tell you, like all the other businesses, what happened in the past, healthcare, whoever gives high valuation, especially private equity guys, in 4 years, 5 years down, they will show the true colors to healthcare. And that will put a lot of pressure on safety and quality and all those clinical programs. That's what I feel. And I, if I have to say honestly, in the last couple of years, when our private equity guy was there for 7 years, he wanted exit, I could see their true colors. They've been with me 7 years, and thankful to that. But they have their responsibility of giving back the return to their LPs. So they're doing their job. We can't find fault with them. But that is not actually, healthcare cannot give, because we as an organization have focused on some rare areas and made a big name and grown big. That's why we could give a decent valuation to them. Otherwise, it would have been a major disaster for any organization. I think that's very important. Whenever you want private equity and other things, you need to be very careful and have a proper conditions and other things. Otherwise, you will be under pressure, under gunpoint if you have to work. Healthcare is not the one. And 5 years, 4 years, you want to give 25% IRR, this is not the business. Okay.
Thank you. So I'll come to Mudit, Madhur, and Ram, but I have a question to Dr. Ballal. So from someone who's experienced it to someone who has not experienced it, but think of a scenario where Sequoia Capital and Carlyle Group and TPG, everyone would like to invest in Manipal. So what is TPG already has. So say Carlyle and Sequoia comes in a big way, and the expectation comes in a big way. So what would be your advice to this group? How would you have to deal with this?
I think one thing is for sure, you need money to grow.
Correct.
And it all depends on where the money comes from. Our experience, honestly, with private equity has been far better than what Dr. Ravindranath has said, maybe because they haven't exited, or not going to exit in the near future. But we have had other people come and exit. So we have had a pretty good relationship. And very honestly, our clinical decision making at no time has been influenced by the private equity. And my point is, if you perform well, you have a good clinical team, you are empathetic to the patients, you deliver the goods to the patients, you build a reputation, your hospital grows, your numbers go, footfalls grow, you do more procedures. The private equity is looking at their returns, which is rightfully so. I think they have put in their money, it's normal for them to expect some returns. And in general, if you have a good image, if your growth is good, your bottom line and top line is good, I think your valuation will be good, and that is where the private equity will be happy. I mean, someone will leave, someone else will come. But if you don't perform well, then I think that's where the problem is. So far, we have been quite lucky, I must be honest, that we have had a good growth, and we have had an extremely good relationship with the private equity. Cannot complain so far.
Excellent. Mudit?
Yeah. So, to add to both of them, our experiences have been very, very interesting. HCG started off with a private equity partner, and we have had two rounds where there was an exit, and now then the second exit, which happened at the time of listing. And now we are a publicly listed company. Interestingly, I would relate to a private equity partner in a certain way of a 1960 Indian marriage. And how it happens is that the boy and the girl, they meet over a coffee or a tea is being served. And that's how it all starts. You have to meet your partner. You have to understand what his expectations are. What are you going to bring on the table? What is he going to deliver on the table? And I think healthcare, as you rightly said, currently if you look at the stands, we are looking at about 11 to 12% kind of a growth which is existing, especially in the hospital sector. If you're looking at that, this has to be made clear right on day one. And there is a certain kind of a role responsibilities which bring in with everyone, as you rightly, as Dr. Ballal rightly pointed out. When the private equity partner walks into this marriage, he brings with him the liquidity with which he's going to help you grow and make your business reach the various parts, which will increase the number of patient footfalls, revenue and everything. On the other hand, you have to be showing your efficiency measures in terms of how much kind of a profitability will you be able to give him back. It's as good as at one point of time when Indian banks were not very liberal. If each one of us have seen our parents or our families owning a bicycle or a scooter was something which everyone had to showcase, and if you had a television, it was kept in the living room, and a telephone was kept in the living room to showcase that how prosperous we are. But today, through the banks and the liquidity being available, you are able to afford it very easily. And that's what private equity does for you. If you can go along as a single-owned hospital or a nursing home, you cannot save that much amount of money. But if you're going to get that liquidity within 4 years or 5 years, and you have the right kind of bandwidth in terms of your project plans, your futuristic or your visions, I definitely feel you can give them that returns. Of course, it all depends on, as I said in the beginning, what is your partner's need and what is he going to bring on the table. If he's expecting something at 17-18%, I personally feel there is a mismatch in the whole marriage. Mm-hmm. I think both of them belong to different strata of society. One is looking at from point A to point B in a BMW, while the other one is looking at a bicycle. And of course, when you ask the guy on a bicycle to ride the BMW, he'll be conscious. If you ask the BMW guy to ride a bicycle, I don't think so. That marriage is going to work very fast. It'll take some time to come.
Thank you. Dr. Ram, you are in a hospital, yep, which is owned by not a private equity, but one of never require money, which is Reliance. Now talk to us about your experience. How do you deal with that expectation? And what is the expectation like, and how it's all about in the environment in Reliance?
I think what my colleagues have been talking about is it all boils down to whether you have a strategic investor or a non-strategic investor. The vision of the strategic investor is, as Dr. Ravindranath said, in alignment with our vision. The vision of the non-strategic investor is partly in alignment as long as things are going his way. The moment things are not going his way, as Dr. Ravindranath said, the colors change. And if you look at the consumer perspective, the aware consumer, one of the biggest issues we were talking about image, about brand building, is there is a perception that here is a service which you have taken, you're infusing capital either through a strategic investor or a non-strategic investor, and there is this perception among the consumer that the moment money comes in, the word targets comes in. The moment targets comes in, there is an ethical issue involved. And this is a big problem which the industry is facing, and this is one of the central issues. Somehow the public feels that the moment money is pumped in, targets is a bad word in healthcare. You can use it in the FMCG sector, you can use it in the service sector, you can use it in the financial services. The moment you have investment targets, there is an assumption which we now have to deal with as to how do you convince that your growth is ethical, your targets in terms of numbers are going to be achieved ethically, because there is a perception that you're going to be unethical to get there. And this is something we will have to work on. And as long as this goes on, it happens in Reliance also. Of course, I don't need to ask money from Reliance. We have become self-sufficient, but if I did, it would be another story. But this is one more angle I want to bring to the whole piece. that we are just not perceived as any other industry. Targets is a bad word. Targets means you are doing unindicated procedures. Targets means you are trying to ramp up numbers. Targets means that you are pressurizing your consultants to do things which they're not supposed to do. It is not the reality in many institutes. But then it comes to how do you manage this perception? And then when you talk about private equity, people have their own opinion about private equity investors, that they are carpetbaggers. They will just, you know, it's like dividend stripping. They will just strip the institute and they will be out in 3 years. So this is the experience we have, which dovetails into what we were talking about. And probably here, the one thing which could help is a strategic investor. But then we don't have enough strategic investors around, and so we have to go to private equity. If we had only strategic investors, I think this would be a different story. Dr. Ravindranath, despite it being Parkway, has had another experience. But this is our take on it. And from the consumer perspective, my biggest concern is this. You have infusion of capital, but we cannot behave like other industries.
Agreed.
We have to be noble. We have to be above board. Targets does not exist in our dictionary. And we are there to serve you as a community. And the government believes that we should be their gods for them, not them. And we should pay the price.
And you have to be professional, show professionalism.
You have to do everything.
Behave like a corporate, but not talk about targets.
You cannot talk about targets.
Exactly. So, Madhur, your point, but I would like to also ask a question with that, what your points are, is there a difference between a doctor investor and a businessman investor?
All right, so I'll go to the first one first. And I've thankfully worn different hats in my life. I've been in private equity. I've seen private equity come in, exit, at least 5 times in my life. I'm doing that once more as we speak. So firstly, let's understand how private equity comes in. It comes in by you putting your current financials and your projected financials on the table and agreeing on certain valuations that would exist based on those numbers. Now, one thing I've realized in my life is investors love predictability. So the common thought process of saying, oh, we can do X, so let's project at least 2X and then do 0.8X. It doesn't work with investors. You say, I'll achieve 0.8X, they're very happy with it. So private equity necessarily isn't bad, but yes, experiences have been mixed across the board, and I understand that. The organization that I work for right now, I was working with ICICI Venture, who was an investor in that organization. ICICI Venture exited, IDFC came in, IDFC is exiting right now, and we're talking to potential investors as we speak. When ICICI Venture exited, they made obviously a good return on it. IDFC is exiting, will make decent return on it. The next guy coming in, I can guarantee will make much more decent return on it. The idea is not for me to have a judgment on private equity versus strategic, but I think healthcare has much more potential in it than we have delivered so far. A typical mature hospital across the board, if you look at financials, delivers not more than 20, 22%, 24% EBITDAs. And I'm very sure we can do much better than that. There's much more in our control without having to look at pricing, without having to look at unethical ways of getting there. And efficiency modeling in healthcare hasn't been looked upon, hasn't been worked on. Yes, there are institutions that I've worked with which are very, very good at it, and we've become better over a period of time. But necessarily to say, I would say private equity versus strategic, both, as long as there's an agreed plan and we stay the course, I don't think pressures are that difficult to manage.
Okay, and difference between a doctor investor and a businessman investor.
All right, so I've...
So we were discussing this,
I started with working for doctor entrepreneurs. I went into professional managerial-led organizations, and I'm currently working with, again, a promoter-driven organization. In my experience, it depends on who and at what stage of evolution is that manager or doctor entrepreneur in that makes all the difference. The idea is to find, there is pros and cons in both. I can for sure bet that he would agree with me that there are pros and cons in either. Doctor entrepreneur led organizations are usually, in my experience, clinically very, very solid. And even in other organizations, if there is a doctor like Dr. Ballal has a very significant role in Manipal, you'll see clinical excellence being driven well. If it is a purely manager-driven organization, it may not reflect that as well if there's no clinical content. So it's got to do with balance. Probably Columbia Asia is the only organization I've worked with where two people at the top work or three people at the top work equally, and it's not a crowd. Mm. But they balance each other well. I think it's got to do with who brings in what on the table and how much of it is actually imbibed into the system. But a pure, a zero or a one, it can't be a digitized healthcare. It can't be zero or a one. It has to be somewhere in between. And based on the strengths and the needs of the organization, people will have to pull in their resources and make things all right. Because if you go only clinical excellence and lose your eye on the P&L, things will go another way. But if you look at only the P&L and don't look at clinical excellence, obviously things are not going to work any which way. So I think it's a mix and balance of both that is required for it to.
Yeah, I think it's quite a tightrope balance. One perspective from the audience, any one perspective someone would like to say is if they are in a hospital which has equity investors, what is the experience? How is it different from if it was not maybe possibly wholly owned earlier from an investor standpoint?
I represent Medica Super Speciality Hospital, and ICICI Venture has invested with us, and we had a good experience and what we achieve is like a win-win situation. Like what we want to deliver, and if we get a partner, and if we are not able to get a strategic partner, so PE is an option to live to your dreams and achieve it. And if the PE want to exit and with a certain condition, if you deliver, there is no problem with it.
Thank you.
Sure. So just to ask in terms of, to add to what Dr. Ram was saying, and I think the question which he mentioned was the word targets. And I think many of us here are from the corporate sector, and I'm sure many of you would have been using. So how many of us use the word targets across the board, if I can see hands? So I think quite a number of us use the word targets. And in fact, knowingly, unknowingly, it has come into our parlance. Of course, the consumer may not like to hear it, or the customer may not like to hear that word, but that's the fact of the industry. It works both ways, as he rightly said. It becomes a kind of a denominator of how we are perceiving our business, but it also becomes in terms of the clinical efficiency at times, and many of the clinicians gets very upset with that. I've seen, and just the ratios which we keep talking about, and I'm sure a lot of you guys who are working in cardiology units, you will say a 1:3 or a 1:4 kind of a ratio, angios converting into a plasty. And of course, a lot depends on what kind of a sector you are. If you are a highly super specialized area, you're doing complex cases, your ratios will be very different. But on an average, if a 1:3 or a 1:4 ratio changes a little bit, I think it becomes very important for the administrators to clinically monitor and audit what is happening there. With the help of the medical audit team, it becomes essential so to ensure that your clinical audit is proper, and such targets which are driven only to give you a certain number, but it does not move in with the practice per se, or the kind of a ratios which we have at the back of our hands, if it is going slightly awry on that, it gives you a very good indicator of the clinical outcomes, and that becomes very important from consumers, as well as it brings back to the whole thing of image, branding and revenues of the hospital. In the long run, it can dent you if the ratios go awry.
The fact remains that as people who have invested and businessmen, they have to have returns. And to have returns, they have to have expectations. My point is, there's no harm in having expectations of X return, Y return, whatever it is. But do not entice or force the medical professionals to do unethical, unnecessary procedures. I don't have a problem if, because of my good work or my team's good work, I do 20 kidney transplants a month instead of 10 or 15, whatever it is. But it would be wrong for me to do unethical ways of buying, selling kidneys and do 20 transplants. That to me is bad. But having increased numbers, I don't think there's anything bad. You have excellent professionals doing more joint replacements is fine. But don't catch hold of every old man walking in your vicinity, bring them in and replace their joint. That is unethical. That's a bad target to have. But if you really get people who need a joint replacement, get their joints replacement, there's nothing wrong. And that is where the differentiation has to be made. And that is where we have faltered very, very badly. Because to us, targets mean you're doing unnecessary procedures. It should not be that way. You can do necessary procedures. You attract more patients. You have good doctors, a good institution, good name, good branding. More people will come to you. Then there's no harm in achieving your targets. But do not achieve it at the cost of ethical practice of medicine.
We were talking about image. The issue of targets being a bad word has come up, or an obscene word, with the consumer. Again, coming back to, because the consumer believes that you do not have the capacity to regulate. If we can convince them that we have the capacity to self-regulate, from a bad word, it will become a good word. And that solely lies with us.
Thank you. In the age of social media, in the age of different business model innovations that are happening, in an age where access and affordability is becoming more and more important, in the age where technology is of very, very importance, in the age where digitization is happening so rapidly, I just wanted to get a sentence each from this panel before we throw it to the audience, is what are you doing to be ahead of the curve in terms of technology and digitization, business model innovation in your respective hospitals? So anyone could start.
Sushobhan, to answer that in terms of what we are doing. So from technology perspective, technology in current scenario has been a great player for healthcare industry. What we have been able to do is we have been able to actually bring down the cost and operational efficiencies by using it. At HCG, what we have done is we have integrated our treatment planning systems, which are in remote centers. So I have places like Gulbarga, I have places like Hubli, Mangalore. These are remote areas, and to get a good technologist, a radiation technologist or a medical physicist over there would be a very challenging issue. So what we do is we would have the images taken over there, and they are sent through a central center at Bangalore, where the images are assimilated, planning is done, and the images are transferred back next day for the treatment. The patient does not have to travel to Bangalore, neither someone has to come here and send the images. It is done, and of course the whole purpose is that we are using technology in that. And that brings down, it helps me two ways. One, penetration into deeper markets in terms of the rural or the peripheral deeper areas. Secondly, it brings up, of course, in terms of cost. The affordability at that point is, of course, challenged. And when you don't employ a certain manpower, it helps me to reduce the cost of the product line there. As a result of which, the service can be rendered at a lower price point. And this works as a win-win situation for both. Looking at Bangalore, where we are working, I've started off with a home care program. In home care program, what we have done is we were looking at chemotherapy times. And most of the times, my patient, the usual routine would be that he would arrive, get a blood test done. He will wait for a TAT of about 45 minutes to one. So early morning, 7 o'clock, he will come. And a day prior, he will book his chemotherapy chair or a bed, which will be from 8:30 onwards. And he will arrive at 8 o'clock, book, get his blood test done. By 9:30, he'll get a report by 9 o'clock. Once he gets his report, and of course, he started at around 6:37 from home, being Bangalore. And 9:30, he has got his test done. The doctor sees. After the round, he says, okay, fit. You go ahead for your platelet count is fine. Go ahead with this. This is your regime. Go pick it up. The pharmacist will take another 45 minutes to mix the drugs, everything, get him. And the actual chemotherapy would start somewhere around 10:30. And that will go on for about 4.5 to 5 hours. So he's going home by not less than 3:34, not prior to that at all. So what we did was we said, well, let's start with a home care program where we started doing pickup of the test a day prior. And at 5 o'clock in the evening, we'll do it a day prior. And by 5 o'clock, we'll have the results. The clinician concerned would go through the test and the results. Once he would go through the test and results, he would say, okay, this guy is fit. So tomorrow morning, 8 o'clock, he can directly come here. Once he's given me a green signal to go, The pharmacy also gets a green signal, gets the drugs ready, everything. It's only on his arrival when I do the drug mixing and then inject it to him. So 8 o'clock, when we will call up the patient at 6 o'clock a day prior in the evening saying, so your spot is booked. What we did was we started using the so-called aggregators. And these aggregators are here like Ola, Uber. And we also talked to our patient saying that, would you need a cab? So I'll order an Ola or an Uber to your place. Now, interestingly, these are so-called disruptors of the technology in the current scenario. But I'm trying to integrate them into my healthcare delivery system. So if the patient sometimes has an issue because the son or the wife or the daughter, they are working, they may not be able to accompany. But I'm going to provide a cab service to him and he can pay it on his own. Or if he wants a hospital, we can bear the cost and put it in the bill, which is a service or a value add which we are offering him. The patient would arrive at 8 o'clock because Uber or Ola will make sure that they will come here in time. The patient arrives here at 8 o'clock, the drugs are ready. 8:45 or 9, he's on the couch. At 1 o'clock or 1:30, he's ready to go. The options are again with him. Would he like to have a drop? Or would he like someone from the home to come and assist him on that? And this was a very interesting example where I started seeing a lot of positive feedback in the patients coming up. The other area which we did was in home care was many of the patients who were at home and were getting treated. The nurses started complaining to me, sir, that most of the time the old man or the person is so fatigued or he's not in a position to. So I sometimes cook food for him. And I said, that's great. So would you like me to run some culinary classes for them? So I said, some of the nurses can be taught that if they want to. And some were very keen. At one point of time, we then had an opportunity to interact with Swiggy, which is again an app. And we got our cafeteria enrolled in that. And within 5 kilometers range, Swiggy will be featuring my hospital cafeteria. So the nurse would automatically call up Swiggy and through the app and say that such and such patient would need a food. And Swiggy would come and pick up the food and deliver that to the patient. Now, the whole concept here was that I am a healthcare provider and logistics is not my forte. And I cannot go around duplicating the logistics part when there are other providers sitting in the market. Why not I use them? I would capitalize on their strengths. Let me capitalize on mine, which is a nursing and a home care and the clinical part. Use these technologies, so-called disruptors of, but they were basically more of aggregators, as I would say. I don't call them disruptors at all. And using them, technology, I was able to achieve a higher patient satisfaction. In fact, my chemotherapy numbers, the dropout rates have drastically reduced because the patient comes to know about whether he's getting treated tomorrow or not. And the confirmation in terms of coming on time, my turnover on the chemotherapy bed has increased because now by 1 o'clock, I have to use only 2 shifts of nurses and the second shift goes off very smoothly. So I personally feel technology, if it has been there, it has been a great help in terms of bringing down the cost, whether it is by image sharing or even using the so-called disruptors who are there in current market. But if you're using them in the right sense, I think they would be helping us a lot in terms of bringing down the price points for the patients too.
My name is Rajat. I am a recent graduate from IIMB Bangalore and I am doing a startup in healthcare sector. Basically, we are working around the EMRs. But we have been trying to promote the EMRs and the use of EMRs across various hospitals. But what we have been seeing is that there is a very, in terms of the adoption of the EMR, there is a lot of resistance from the doctors and even the hospital side. And what we have figured out when we talk to a lot of people that unless there is a push from the corporate side, the management of the hospitals, or from the government side that the EMRs need to be adopted, doctors don't start readily adopting it. There have been hospitals, for example, Medanta, Columbia Asia, Manipal Hospital, who have been using EMR because the management have pushed it. That's what the doctors told us. But it's a very, in terms of the broad trend in the adoption of EMRs, the basic technology, it's in the healthcare sector. Apart from that, because based on the EMR, you can do a lot of preventive healthcare analytics. You can. For the question is what if the thing that you see in terms of why is this adoption not happening and what can we do, what can be done to make this happen?
I'll take the question because I agree with you 100%. When we introduced electronic medical records in our hospital, the first ones to adapt were the nurses, the smartest in the hospital. The worst were the doctors, and it was directly proportional to their age. Older the doctor, less their doctor. My point is, I think technology has to be user-friendly. And this is, I say, with a lot of responsibility, because if I'm seeing 100 patients and I have about barely 5 or 10 minutes for a patient, if the technology takes 20 minutes for me to see a patient, I'm not going to adopt it. It's probably a lot easier for me to hire someone to use the electronic medical records for me, and I see 100 patients. So I think that is where the doctors have faulted, at least more of the older doctors. I see a lot of adoption among the younger doctors, but I agree with you that most of the technology adoption has happened with the nursing staff much earlier than the doctors. I think that's one is, of course, they have not grown with technology, at least the older doctors. Secondly, I think at least many of the systems that I have seen are not as user-friendly. It honestly takes you about 3 times more time to enter all the data into the medical records as you would have done without doing what you do on the computer, which is, to me, a waste of my time.
Right, sir.
If I can see only 3 patients in an hour instead of 10, yes, that's not something that I will accept. So I think we need to have an answer to that question before the doctors adopt it really.
As an extension of Dr. Ballal's statement, most of the EMR is developed by people who have no domain expertise. That's why it's not user-friendly. Right? Later on, a lot of doctors and all who has got technology interests have been recruited into the various companies. Now it's better. That's why EMR adoption is much higher now than when we started. Even the best of the companies like Wipro, Siemens, big, including TCS, they had to change their electronic medical records and hospital information system several times before they really got it better.
Right.
So that's, I think, domain expertise is something very important, so that it is user-friendly and also it doesn't waste our time. Any right. clinician doesn't want to waste time. They've got limited time, they've got a lot of patients. Successful doctor has lots of patients, limited time. So he needs to deliver that.
Right.
Dr. Ravindranath said is exactly what we talk about when we talk about democratizing innovation. So Eric von Hippel has written a book on this. And basically, this story in hospitals can also be seen in ski boards, for example. If you involve doctors upfront in developing the EMR, because they are the lead user, the innovation becomes more consumer friendly. And that's something that might be thought about as a business model complement to the product innovation that you're already doing.
There is a white paper currently which is being prepared, agreed on as to what would be the standard that Indian healthcare would use. Also from not only regulatory perspective, but even payer perspective, many health insurance companies are moving that direction to say, I do not want paper, give me electronic medical record. So I don't see the question on the table whether it will happen. As they rightly said, it has to be user friendly. I worked in a particular organization, and I would not name it, that implemented MedTrack, which at that point of time in early 2000 was the gold standard, and ended up with 78 transcriptionists outside every single doctor's office to transcribe, which is really not EMR implementation. So it is going to go there, but if it is not user-friendly, it's not going
to
work.
Sir, I'd like to share my experience with the EMR, which I was just sharing with my other colleagues during
Sir,
the lunch break.
Can you introduce yourself?
Yeah, I'm Dr. Dipankar Sen. I'm one of the orthopedic surgeons from West Bengal. During my working career in the United Kingdom, we came across this EMR things. And the University of Leeds have carried out a research that if to perform a task, a doctor or a person needs to do more than 4 clicks, they will not use it. So this is something we experienced during our working time also, because x-rays and things we needed to order. And yes, we have felt that if I just need to write x-ray both knee AP lateral in standing posture, I myself take about, I'll say 15 to 20 seconds. And if that requires 4 or 5 clicks, it goes up to almost 30, 40 seconds, people automatically reject it. So this is something I thought will be worth sharing with all of you. Thank you.
I'm Suhas. I'm taking care of the medical administration at BL Kapoor Hospital, Delhi. My question is pertaining to the first half of our symposium. I hope to solve that thing in my mind, more of a neutral perspective, though I work for a corporate house. It's a very neutral thing to understand and to expect that when we are talking about regulation as such, there is no regulations available as of now, and as discussion came out that we are getting there. If government is not able to help or stand for those that regulation for hospital, private hospitals, and private hospitals being a biggest player right now in the current scenario, why is something, I'm just throwing it out of the box, why is something like a consortium of these big houses formed to regulate those policies, to bring it for near future, for other private hospitals to enter in the market, to regulate those and standardize those services, which will directly affect the outcome of the care and, of course, the pricing, differential pricing, which will, on a larger picture, will help all the patients of the country. Because there are many, many patients, patients are more, but the healthcare facilities are still less. So in terms of ethical part, in terms of costing, in terms of everything, it will still benefit all the organizations who want to do it. Why there is no consortium? I'm sorry, but I'm comparing it with an FMCG. Pepsi and Coca-Cola also have a consortium. They do the pricing, but then they have the consumer base. It's a demand and supply.
I won't say a consortium, but they are representative bodies which are have the will of all these hospitals represented in that.
My question is all for the panelists. I think we all understand that digital marketing is a way forward, you know, that's a big segment which is out there. But all of us, I think, largely agree that digital marketing in India, particularly in healthcare, is in a very nascent stage. And I also have a feeling that, you know, most of the hospitals, do they really believe that digital marketing as a medium of advertisement or in branding, can they deliver? On a long-term basis, I feel that digital marketing is going to really help to actually target the audiences which you are trying to, you know, go and engage with. What is your view that, you know, do you think digital marketing is going to play a very important role in the healthcare industry as such?
I think all of us, I probably will speak for everyone, but I think all of us do believe that there's a huge role for digital marketing, and I think that is something of the future, and most hospitals are investing in digital marketing. I agree with you, it has still been in a very nascent stage, but I think most hospitals are seriously looking at it for the future.
But again, I would really get in, and this all talks about the image as well. We talked about targets, profitability, marketing. Again, if you look at the general population of the patient, somehow marketing of a hospital or marketing of a medical devices or a marketing of a pharmaceutical is not acceptable in India. I was in the US for 3 weeks in New York, and believe me, whenever I was looking at the channel, TV, either it was showing Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton, or it was showing advertisements of hospitals, pharmaceutical products, or medical devices products, all the time. So I think the perception again comes up in terms of marketing, and maybe the digital marketing is something that could be much better, provided the acceptance of the consumer is much better. I think we should address that first before going into full-fledged digital marketing.
Apart from that, Sushobhan, I think the question here is that what is the penetration of digital marketing for my consumer, and which block of consumer I am looking at? Okay, interestingly, all of us who are sitting here would have a chunk of a digital marketing budget which actually goes and attracts my international patient more rather than my local patient. Correct. Or my domestic guy. The domestic patient goes around having a ref check about the hospital and the doctor. But an international market is a segment which we all target, so we all make sure that our digital marketing is actually addressing that. And you will have one-to-one chat windows open up when you go into our websites. Those are the guys who are actually directly talking to the customer. But I'm not very sure the penetration of digital marketing in domestic market, how strong it is and how deep it is. So the customer focus depends, and accordingly the marketing site or the website gets updated accordingly, depending on the customer.
I don't have any questions, just sharing 2 minute experience on the first part of the discussion, like investor and management relationship. So I am working very closely with the investors, and they are not idiots. Like what Madhur said, if we have projected something and you are not achieving that, then is there a problem. If you have projected 1x and your revenue is 1x, then the investors are very, very good with you. So this is all about trust, and what you have projected, you need to achieve that. First, about the investment. And the second is about the technology. We have to run ahead of from the time for the technology, right? So what we are using our glucometer, which are SIM-enabled and connected with the patients 24/7. We are at least 3 years ahead of the time. So maybe we are not making money this time, but we are sure if we are doing right thing with the technology at the right time, we definitely make money. So this is the experience which I wanted to share.
Hello, my name is Sachin Maheshi. I run a startup called MedSync. So we are like Netflix for patient education. So we do short videos, right? Two-minute videos covering the entire spectrum of a procedure, pre-op, post-op, home care, all those things, right? So the question I have is, you know, I have some challenges on the Indian market, right? So the question here is twofold, right? What is the role of patient education from a provider's perspective, whether it's a hospital owner or a doctor? That's one. Second thing is, I'm struggling with positioning this product in the sense that if I go and tell a doctor saying that this will help you productivity, nobody's interested. But the moment I open the mouth around conversion, everybody's all ears. And I'm facing a challenge, right? Should I start selling in terms of conversion?
That's actually brand building over a period of time, and also bringing the transparency in the treatment what you are giving. And by doing that, certainly you can do conversions also over a period of time. It's a long term. But we can't really promise how much conversions you get. Okay. But patient education is the way to go for most of the organization, especially in if you are in a tertiary care, quaternary care, where complexities are there. It is a basic primary care, at least, you know, some knowledge is there. And it's not so complex to understand somebody who's interested. There is a net and everything. But complex problems, there is so much to do a patient education. I agree. I think you need to sit with the right organizations and probably modify it here and there to improve the conversions or to convince them it will do more conversions.
So I'll add to what he said, and I'm building on what Dr. Ballal said earlier. It's also a component of time. If he wants to see 100 patients and counsel all the 100 patients as to what to expect in dialysis before, during, after, he's not seeing 100 patients. He's seeing 10 patients a day. So I think there is an efficiency to it. There's a clinical benefit to it. And whether conversions or not, obviously it will. But these two components itself should be good enough for you to sell the product. There are many more such organizations who do it. And I wouldn't know what base are you using. But both from core content perspective and efficiency perspective, it makes sense.
With the moderator's permission, yes, a quick piece of advice for the young man. I think, in our opinion, most of the medical legal cases that doctors face is because of poor patient education. So you can promise the doctor, your lawyer bills will be much lower if you use me. So I think he should use that as you're selling propaganda rather than conversions, non-conversions, so on and so forth. And it's a serious business. I think a well-educated patient is less likely to sue you than a patient who has very little information. I think that would be the great marketing thing for you, and we expect a royalty for that.
Yeah. I think I'll add to Dr. Ballal. I think he's definitely right. If you put that, that would be the right route. But try to understand who your customer is. Is patient your customer right at that point of time whom you're selling the product, or is the doctor? And if it's the customer is the doctor, you need to understand what he wants, and then you'll have to moderate. Of course, I'm sure you have already worked out on the nitty-gritties of language, etc., on your patient portals, education portals. But it depends as where you are showcasing it and who your target audience is. If it's the doctors, I think you need to understand where they are coming from, and then need to incorporate that in your system.
So my question is in alignment with the image of the hospitals which we are talking about. And more than the word digital marketing, I personally believe in the word digital engagement for the hospitals. What I understand for a little bit of experience compared to you all I have is the physicians in any hospital, in whatever technology we are forwarding forward, whatever we see are still the major stakeholders in the entire, you know, success of an organization. But still, there's a lot of dissatisfaction which prevails in the physicians because of this contradiction of the thought process or their the projections, okay? Because hospital always wants to project their brand. And in that case, a lot of physicians are dissatisfied because they might be very good clinically. They are not utilized properly. They might have a lot of other, me being a physician, I feel, okay, I am a good clinician. I might be, utilized in other resources as well. So there's a lot of dissatisfaction which is currently prevailing in doctors, who are part of the hospital, and in terms of management. There is not proper connection. So can we utilize them better? Can we make them part of the decision-making process or a part of major stakeholders or something like that, where the retention rate improves, the patient education model improves, we give them better platform that they're not only clinicians who are just coming here, doing the OPDs and just taking the salaries or taking the cuts, whatever, but also playing a major role in the overall development of the health organization. And if we don't consider them being part as very important part and being part of every aspect of the healthcare, I think we'll still lack into full development.
I personally feel, let's understand this very clearly, the patient comes not because of the administrator or the hospital per se. He comes there for the clinical output or the competency which sits there. And if they are not part of the decision-making process, I personally feel you are missing the big point in the whole picture. It's the clinician who drives, and we are support structures around him, whether it's the infrastructure, the admin staff. So we need to be very, very cognizant of his needs, his demands, and he has to be a part of the policy matters in terms of, I'm not talking about the administrative policies, but at least the clinical policies in terms of critical pathways, in terms of how he wants to define his patient flow, his movement, treatment part. Financials, if you really ask a clinician, he'll say, what is my fee? That's all he's not interested in what is happening to the hospital. But I think that's where you need to be very careful about, that you make sure that this is the competency, will be the price points, and how are you going to build the whole structure around it to facilitate him. I think most of the trained doctor, managerial staff, they go into a thought process that clinicians are one and management is one. And I personally feel that that is not the right approach at all. You are part of the same picture. It's just how you are going to catalyze and be together in a synergistic manner so that you get a thorough output out.
Just to add to it, I'm a clinician and promoter. And then in our organization, there are many doctors who have got a significant stake also in the organization. Each organization has slightly different way of looking at it. I agree with you. Some organizations, doctors are not projected in the media and digital media, and I know that. Even in our own organization, some of the leading doctors are projected, younger guys wants, you're not projecting me, and these things do happen. But I think, as Mudit said, partnership with doctors, that's what we need to create in their mind. It is their business and our business, and both of us together providing service to a customer. I think that they need to look at this as a partnership and grow together.
So I believe it should be planning of the entire hospital system itself, where the role of the doctor should not be limited only to the clinical aspect. It should be also education in the form of your digital engagement. It need not be marketing your product and services, but the doctor's education information which needs to be sent in different media channels.
I think it's very important. Maybe IIM should come up with a crash course for all the doctors on health economics and health.
Yeah. Sir, they've already started. They've started this GMHE program for healthcare professionals.
I think you are looking at a certain model, but if you look at most of the new models, the corporates, if you want to build loyalty to an organization and you want participative management, they have to be part of the organization. By definition, that means you have to go for the full-time specialist system where they are almost quasi-employees of your organization. Most of the large groups now are aligning to that model. The moment they become part of your organization, not visiting consultants, in all organizations there is participative management. In our institute, every director is responsible for the P&L, is part of a strategic business unit, and that applies in most of the organizations. It is not that they take only clinical decisions. They are fiscally responsible also. They are responsible for the growth. So it depends. If you look at most of the organizations, it already exists. They are not dissociated. They are dissociated in organizations where they are, you know, transit passengers. They come in and go out. Well, then you cannot have them guiding the policies. But if they are aligned to your organization, most organizations are already into it. It's participative management.
I'll just, to extension, we have done a model in Mumbai Hospital as a subsidiary. Our leading 7 or 8 doctors owns 35% stake. We own the majority, that subsidiary. And they're all directors of their departments. Literally, when we sit in the management committee, all of them come and sit. Sometimes it's difficult, they throw their weight, but by and large, they take it as their own, and it helps, it helps.
I have a question from point number one and point number three. So there's a, all of us know P&Ls, the price of our procedures, even we are not meeting inflation. But I connect with point number three and point number one, like image management. If I look at our strata, our customer base, which all of corporate private hospitals are serving today, is the upper end of the society. We are a top end, top 15-20%. So I am just correlating the experience of telecom. Like if you go back 15 years back till 2001, when incoming calls became free, telecom companies was always think like us that they are making for money and they have profits only. But when they went for masses, so the image has changed now. So my thought is, as a healthcare industry, we may also have to go to masses with a low cost model. So we may have to go to the urban area, rural areas, in urban areas also low cost model. So what's the thought process of all the panelists that when do you think another 5 years, 10 years we'll achieve that low cost model so that it's affordable and there's no tag of profit or money with private healthcare?
Besides having the tertiary and quaternary care hospitals, segmentation and targeting of the market has already started. Low cost models are being introduced. The process has started. The thing is, many of the industries are 5-10 years ahead of us in terms of penetration. I think models are being put in place by most providers where you clearly have segments of the market and you are evolving products to meet the needs of that segment. You've just not seen it roll out in a big way yet.
Other important reason why it is not rolled out is this is a service. You're dealing with the human life. It's a serious business. And you can't really do a conveyor belt kind of model. But to a certain extent, you know, Devi Shetty succeeded doing a large number of cardiac surgeries at a low cost. Well, that's how many can do it? How many people can replicate it? It's a big question mark. And skill, safety, all those things are there.
To give you some numbers around it, we... in my organization, Sahyadri, we do close to 22% of our revenue from RGJY, which is the Rajiv Gandhi or the Yashwasini or whatever else you could call it. It's a government insurance scheme for the poor. And we make 50% contribution net of doctor cost. So it is financially viable for sure.
Yep.
So Anurag, just to close this, at our centers also, I told you how we have been able to bring down cost in the peripheral centers. The price points are low, and of course the treatment modalities would be more towards generic until unless the patient is requiring an innovator or a branded product line. So there are models which are working on that, and as he was adding regarding provisioning of healthcare, whether it is diagnostics, integrating with doctors, remote teleconsultations and stuff like that. That's where we are able to bring down the cost. And of course, we are being pushed into it and we are experimenting also with this.
Oh, this is Jayanti Chatterjee, APP Operations from MRI Hospitals, Kolkata. So while chasing the outstanding, so do we have any law, or if it is not, can we have any law or ask for a law to realize those monies actually?
Already a Supreme Court judgment which we are battling, which has said that recovery of dues of a patient cannot translate into illegal confinement of the patient. There is a law, they have clearly said, go file a civil suit and go for recovery. Mm. It's very clear the Supreme Court has passed that. You cannot illegally confine a patient. Does that give license to everyone not to pay and go? Probably 90% do not. But like the NPA or the bad debt, you will have to go and fight to recover your dues in the appropriate forum, which is a civil suit. They've clearly said that, and there's no other way to get it.
What is one single word that comes to you when we talk about government?
Indecisive.
Dr. Ram, what do you think about when you look at quality? What is the one single word that comes out to you in terms of healthcare quality?
The lack of attention to detail.
One word.
Detail. The devil is in detail.
Devil is in detail. Dr. Ballal, when we talk about ethics, what is the single thing comes to you which is synonymous with ethics?
Treat the patient like your family.
He's too senior, I can't tell him one word again. Mudit, what does funding mean to you? One word.
Growth.
Growth, fantastic. Doctor, what does superior clinical outcomes resonate to you? Superior clinical outcomes. You're a clinician. One word.
Patient delight.
Patient delight. Thank you. So with this, let us hear from each one of them one single most biggest critical key takeaway for the audience.
I'm actually going to steal what he said. You could talk at 40,000 feet level and I could give you tons of gyan for the next 17 centuries. But till you don't crystallize that into what needs to be done now here to change things and make them better, most likelihood 3 days after you won't remember anything that was spoken in the last 3 days. So the idea is to convert ideological questions and dilemmas into actionables that you can put on ground and make things go from point A to point B.
Excellent, thank you. Dr. Ram?
I think in healthcare, I was talking to you, the single sustainable differentiator is service excellence, and which is service excellence in clinical outcomes. Please do not think that superior quality in terms of clinical outcomes costs money. It does not. It requires attention to detail. Do the ordinary extraordinarily well in your hospital and medical practice, and you've reached 90%. I'm telling you that. It is not technology which costs billions of dollars and everything else, all the bells and whistles. Just do what physicians used to do extremely well earlier, which we have stopped doing, which is pay attention to detail, listen to the patient, treat the patient well, do that extraordinarily well, and you are well on the way on the highway. You don't need to spend tons of money for quality.
Golden words. Thank you. Dr. Ballal.
I think my biggest problem in healthcare has been patient dissatisfaction in the recent events. The vandalization of hospitals, beating up our doctors. And to me, probably the most important factor in this has been the pricing and the cost of medical care. What has happened is we have still not transitioned of a third world country offering third world care about 3 decades ago to a third world country now offering first world care, but the expectation of the patients that is we should still charge them in the third world way, which doesn't happen. We cannot not charge for expensive care, and we have not found a common ground, and the day we find the common ground, I think we'll have the best healthcare in this country.
Well said, thank you.
Thank you.
Madhur, Mudit,
just to add, my thinking is, I think all of you need to be aware. In terms of aware means open to ideas, with patient as your center, and that's most important. And need to be aware, experimental, with all these areas, focusing on the patients, and make sure that across whatever you are doing, the focus has to be the patient, and ease of access of care for the patient is the mantra for it. And you have to use all the resources, which is your openness, your experimental nature for this.
Thank you. Dr. Ravindranath?
In my view, patient is God for both doctors and the hospital, and patient is paying all of our salaries. I think that we need to bring patient is the most important person in the hospital. That culture, if you can bring some of your managers in your hospitals, who you are managing, half the battle is won. After that, bring the doctors together, work as a team with a good communication. Majority of the things fall in place. Then the P&L will automatically happen.
So let me thank the panelists for this outstanding, outstanding insight. Thanks a lot. And give a big hand to each one of you for being a great audience. Thank you, Chirantan and the IIMB, for giving us the opportunity. And I think this program is going well, and we are looking forward to the evening. Thank you.
Thank you. A quick vote of thanks to the entire J&J team for supporting the program, to our IIMB Executive Education team for nurturing the program for the last 3 years. I see two alumnus from past batches already in the, I saw you, Prashant, in the house. So obviously we are generating the right kind of signals in the ecosystem. And also to everybody around the ecosystem in the community here in IIMB for coming and making some time for the discussions.